Where in education have you sort of seen uses of technology that have benefited?
Teacher is the pivot around whom the education revolves. Technology can play a phenomenal role in that.
Any task that can be routinized, okay, like I mean, and where you can instruct with an algorithm is something that a computer can potentially and almost certainly will do better than a human.
It is so much harder to pay for EdTech today versus paying for, say, painting your classroom.
You know, like in any other segment, technology has been, will be, and continue to be a game changer. So, for example, we've been talking about relieving the child of the burden of the bag that he carries, the books. Technology can be a game changer. So, we had already started using QR codes in books where we could eliminate some material and use the QR code. But that probably will spread as technology spreads. At this point in time, web connectivity is not there in most of the places, but I'm very hopeful that over a period of time that will come through. So over a period of time, it will relieve the child of the burden that he has. Mind you, it will not replace the teacher, it will not replace the books, but it will facilitate and help the teacher as well as reduce the size of the books in terms of delivering education. Second, technology obviously can be used for video content, for audio content, for transmission purposes, for value adding to whatever is being taught. Teacher is the pivot around whom the education revolves. Technology can play a phenomenal role in that. I remember we launched a portal called Deeksha. You know, one of the problems with the teachers is that in some of the states of the country, the teachers don't go to the school. A World Bank study revealed that 25% of the teachers in these states do not go to the schools.
Wow.
Now imagine the impact it has on the education. Now look at how technology can change this. So we started with the experiment in Chhattisgarh, wherein we gave one tablet, which was GPS linked to every school, and the teachers were asked to give this biometric impression. Attendance improved dramatically. So was the case in Andhra Pradesh. So technology can be used for that purpose. Then for further, that tablet itself could be used for upgrading the skills of the teacher by giving them material on the tablet which they could use. Similarly, it could help the student. So there are a number of ways in which technology can be used in education itself. I can go on and on. But in every segment, technology can be a game changer. It is already changing it, but it can be used phenomenally.
Almost everybody thinks at some level that technology is good for instruction, education, EdTech. So, you know, one of the most high-profile elements of this was the one laptop per child movement, right? It was almost evangelized as a way of kind of bringing children into the 21st century. And many countries would just kind of drink the Kool-Aid and saying, "Achha, ye to karna hi hai," like, and we need to just spend and do it. Now, fortunately, what happened in Peru was the Inter-American Development Bank, as part of their support to the government to do this, you know, strongly recommended that this be evaluated carefully, okay? So what they did was they did a randomized controlled trial where, you know, they phased it in and they used a lottery to decide which phase would happen first. And then they compared outcomes over an extended period, 1 year or 2 years, even longer, and basically found zero impact, okay? So here is this incredibly high profile one laptop a child program, and they found zero impact on learning. Now, of course, when you do the postmortem afterwards, like, I mean, people say, "Oh, it was obvious." But that's because giving the hardware did nothing in terms of integrating pedagogy, like, I mean, into the platform, okay? Now, all of these things seem obvious afterwards, but the fact is still that hundreds of millions of dollars were spent. any task that can be routinized, okay, like and where you can instruct with an algorithm is something that a computer can potentially and almost certainly will do better than a human, okay? But when there is a task that requires contextual kind of awareness and processing, then the human still does much better than the computer. And in those cases, a well-designed system will allow the technology to make the human much more productive, okay? So I very much believe that education sits in the latter group. So I don't see any fear whatsoever, like a mean of a teacher being replaced by a technology. Rather, I think if you, the opportunity here is to kind of deconstruct every task that a teacher does and think about which are the functions that are the most boring, right? That can be automated. And how do you then use teacher time to do the things that are higher value added that a teacher can do much better than a computer? So to give you a simple example, I think where a technology or computer-based platform can do much better is in terms of customizing instruction in a classroom. How do you handle variation? So even a highly motivated teacher cannot teach 20 different students 20 different things, okay? So that may be something that a computer could do better. But a computer could also do grading better, for example, you know, and save the teacher the drudgery of that. But what we increasingly see is that the research in the labor market returns to education. Make it clear that what increasingly matters are non-academic skills, right? Social skills, interpersonal skills, psychological skills of grit, of being able to deal with adversity. So the role of the teacher, over time, I see pivoting a lot more towards teaching these kind of, not, I would say, to the exclusion of, but it's all about relative emphasis, right? Emphasizing much more the skills of group work, skills of collaboration, skills of how do you deal with failure, working on all of those packages of education that are not just about kind of, you know, cramming you on certain formulas and math. So I think I see this as a huge opportunity, but of course, with every opportunity, it requires work to then kind of reimagine a classroom, reimagine what the structure of instructional time looks like to then leverage the advantage of the technology while pivoting teacher time towards doing things that the teacher would do better than the technology.
The last mile is still an issue in India. And the teacher's adoption of technology is also poor. It is it's not something that they have grown up seeing, and it's not something that they naturally take up. But what gives me hope are two extreme examples. One is from our government work in Haryana, where we have almost moved to a system of sending training videos to teachers on WhatsApp, because it was becoming very difficult to pull out the teachers from the classrooms again and again for content training. And that has had huge adoption. Almost 80-90% teachers actually view these lectures, and through a monitoring system, we are being able to also see that they're actually delivering that in the classroom.
Fantastic.
So that gives me a lot of hope. So the other extreme example is that of Avanti, which is an IIT JEE coaching program. So their teachers are expert teachers. They have a different problem. Their problem is that they would not want to accept anyone else's material for teaching. And they have a huge adoption of the training videos as well, because they see value in those. So looking at those two extreme examples, yes, last mile is a problem. Process adherence in general in India is an issue. So, you know, take up and adherence in teachers is also an issue in India. But these two examples give me hope that if you are creating value for the teacher, if you are saving her time and making her more effective, teachers are our smartest individuals, right? If they see it, then they will adopt it.
So Prachi, children are going either to the free government schools or the private schools when we talk about the K-12 education landscape, right? Which means ultimately, either the government has to pay or a parent has to pay for some of these EdTech solutions that we've been talking about. Otherwise, we will never be able to reach the scale that we are dreaming of, right? Philanthropy is only a bridge towards that. Do you think that they will ever pay? Do you think the governments or retail parents will ever pay for EdTech solutions or other interventions?
You're very right, and you frame it beautifully, Pranav, that philanthropy is only a bridge to that stage before government starts paying or the parents themselves start paying. Let's first talk about parents. It's easier. So if you come to think of our parents, especially, you know, those who are living very underprivileged lifestyles today. So are these parents paying? Yes, they are paying. They're paying as high as 20, 30, 40% of their earnings towards their children's education by sending them to private schools, by sending them to tuitions, irrespective of whether or not they are in government schools or private schools. So yes, the parents are paying. Are they paying for EdTech? No, they're not paying for EdTech. At least our experience doesn't show that they're paying for any form of education technology at scale in India today. But that's a segment I'm very hopeful of, right? Because they understand that they need better quality for their children. They've already opened their wallet to pay for better quality. And if EdTech actually delivers on that promise and communicates that to the parents, that yes, I am able to give your child better education than what your school is and tuition is being able to provide, they will pay. That's the question which I have no doubt about. Government is a trickier one, right? It's always a tricky one. Should they pay? Of course they should pay. Will they pay at some point of time? They will pay. When will that time be is hard to predict, but what needs to be done before they start paying, at least to us, is clear. We believe that when, again, you know, these metrics become standardized and they become widely and adopted in the system and widely accepted in the system, that's a step one of the government to be able to pay. Come to think of it, right? I mean, we all blame the government for not paying for some of these services. It is so much harder to pay for EdTech today versus paying for, say, painting your classroom, right? You wanted your class to be painted white, you ordered white paint, they brought white paint and they painted it up. And you can see at the end and you can cut a check for that. When you're using public funds to be able to do the same for education, it's not as black and white, and we are not collectively making an effort to make it black and white. So at least that step one has to happen. Whether or not it will happen even after the step one is accomplished, it is very hard to say, but I am very hopeful. The reason I'm very hopeful is that all the efforts that the government is making today is sort of prepping us for that. We are already talking about distributing laptops to our teachers or some form of hardware to our teachers. We are talking about personalized education. We are talking about learning outcomes. You and I know that these were not conversations that we are having even 5 or 6 years ago.
Right.
They are doing pilots. So both the government of Rajasthan, where you guys are working, EI is working very closely, is doing a large scale pilot on not just EI solutions with Mindspark, but so many other companies, right, with Avanti, with Convergenius, with English learning solutions. Government of Haryana is doing it. Andhra Pradesh is doing it. So there are many of these state governments which are actively engaging with technology, and you know, they have adopted technology in many other areas. So it's a matter of time. I'm not thinking like even decades over here. I'm thinking it's few years, and what we have to do in those few years, we have to make those matrix much better understood, much widely accepted, much simpler for that eventual adoption to happen.